I'll continue with module identification, but this time in the prism of evolution, or by integrating data from different species. And the reason we think this is timely and interesting is because we've seen many graphs like it throughout the week. But if we look at the number of species that have been, for which some protein interaction data has been measured, then you can see that there is some exponential growth, and it's probably time to start taking advantage of this. And again, we are interested in building this machine that will take the hellebore and produce some modules that can be interpreted and followed, etc. The reason why we think that it's good to use cross-species information for that is because what we've been talking about, that the data is so partial and noisy, and maybe by using information from different species, we would be able to enhance our predictions. So the basic paradigm that is being used here is the following. If something is conserved in evolution, it is probably functional. So if we see some subnetwork, this is conserved in evolution, which means that both its proteins are conserved in evolution. They are sort of sequence similar. This is indicated by the dashed edges here. And its interactions are conserved in evolution, it may be functional. So if we start with some module that we predict on a specific network, maybe it's something that is statistically significant but not biologically significant. However, if we see something that is copied over two or more networks, then we have more reason to believe that this may be a truly functional module, and therefore there is a lot of power in the multiple species information. So there are sort of three subfields in this cross-species analysis of networks. One of them is what we call local network alignment, which means that we are trying to detect subnetworks or modules that are conserved across two or more species. One of them is called global network alignment, which means that we are taking two networks and we are trying to find a one-to-one or maybe a many-to-many mapping between them. And the last sort of subfield that people have been doing research on is what is called network querying, which means that we have some subnetwork that interests us in one species and we would like to discover whether it occurs in another species. And not surprisingly, all these names are derived from the sequence analogy. So of course you know that sequence alignment has been very influential in biology, and the hope is to carry this beyond sequences to networks. Due to the interest of time, I will talk only about these two, and I won't have time to go into global network alignment. So I'll start with local pairwise alignment, which means we are trying to find conserved subnetworks using two species. So the problem is as follows. We are given two networks, one for each species, and we are trying to find pairs of subnetworks, one from each species, that are significantly similar. And the similarity, you should always keep in mind that it's measured in terms of both the node similarity, so the sequences, and the edge similarity, which corresponds to the actual interactions that are observed. And this problem, under certain formulations, for example, when you look for a small subnetwork within a large network, have NP complete or NP hard translations. So of course we will strive to find algorithms that can that are either heuristic or fixed parameter that can somehow bypass this complexity issue. One data structure that was used a lot in the works that I'm going to describe is a network alignment. This is simply sort of a complex graph that has both networks together in it in a way that facilitates the identification of conserved subnetworks. So what is a network alignment? Each vertex corresponds to two proteins, one from each species, so the green species and the orange species, that are sequence similar. Okay, and sequence similarity is, of course, there is some threshold that you put, and you put those vertices only if these sequences are similar enough. And each edge corresponds to some conserved interaction. Again, it's not necessarily that in the two species there was actually a direct interaction between the corresponding proteins, but it could mean, and we'll see specific examples for that, it could mean that in one of the species, for example, in the green species, there was a direct physical interaction between those two proteins, and in the other, maybe there wasn't a direct interaction, but maybe, for example, there was a LENS2 path between them. Okay? So this is the network alignment graph. It was first used in a metabolic-oriented work by Ogata et al. In 2000. It was later used by many others, and it's simply a convenient data structure that facilitates the search for conserved subnetworks. So the first work that I'm aware of that does a local network alignment is a work that I was also involved in by the lab of Trey Heidecker, and it's called PathBLAST. And the idea there was to start by identifying in a network alignment graph path of lens 4, and then group all these paths together into subnetworks that are conserved. So it was sort of a heuristic idea. And in this specific implementation of a path alignment, an edge could mean that both interactions were direct, or that one of them was direct and the other was a gap, like gaps in sequence alignment, or that both interactions were indirect, so sort of lens 2, which is called here a mismatch. And it's interesting that the work was applied to the two networks that were available back then. So one is from some bacteria, H. pylori, the other from yeast. You can see the sizes of the networks back then. And even when you simply look at how well are interactions conserved across the two species compared to what would happen if you again merge the two networks, but this time you permute the names of the nodes previous to the to constructing the network alignment graph, you already see that the conservation is not random. For example, there were only 7 interactions that were actually conserved in both species, but in a random integration of the networks, you only get 2.5 plus minus 1.9 and so on. So 260 gap interactions compared to 70 in a random graph and so in a random integration and so on. So what can you gain from such an analysis? So there are different insights you can gain about the evolution and the function of the networks. So here is one example, and the way to read all the graphs that I will present is as follows. What you see here are the subnetworks of each species. So pylori is in orange, yeast is in green. On every row, you place proteins that are sequence similar, okay? And the edges correspond to protein-protein interactions. They could be either indirect or direct. So the first insight that you can gain from such an alignment, you can start to reason about autology between proteins. So of course, when you take a protein and you want to know who is its autolog in another species, there could be only one answer, so one sequence similar protein, but there could be many answers. So for example, 10 proteins that are all significantly similar to this protein, but you know, but the difference between them is, you know, in the exact statistical significance score, okay? But they could be very close. So for example, this protein, if you look at its best match does not even occur here. However, its placement in an alignment in the same place as those proteins could suggest that one of them is the true functional autolog of this protein. So in this case, the network alignment gives you a context of a function to help you resolve autology ambiguities. Another obvious insight that you can get from such an alignment is you can use it to predict the function of proteins. So for example, this was an unknown protein back at the time. However, its placement in interaction with the polymerase of the pylori and opposite proteins that take part in DNA replication in yeast suggest that it also takes part in DNA replication. And a third insight is that sometimes these alignments can connect together, link together processes that were not known to interact. In this case, it's DNA replication and protein degradation. Okay, so these are important insights that you can get from this evolutionary analysis of one or more networks. How do you try to attack it computationally? So the idea, or the basic idea that was used in subsequent works, was to generalize the single species scoring. So in a single species, we were searching for dense subgraphs. So here you are searching also for dense subgraphs, but you also have a second requirement that you want the subgraphs that you find to be dense, you want them also to match in their sequences. So you can write some likelihood ratio score that is very similar to what we had before, right? That talks about the density of each one of the sets that you are identifying, but also ties them together by requiring that for every pair of proteins that are matched, their similarity is more than what you would expect at random. Now, what is not satisfying about this score is that somehow it doesn't say anything about how these subnetworks evolved. Okay, it's something very sort of, I don't know, mathematical. You want dense sets that somehow match, but it doesn't apply what principles we know from protein network evolution. So, what do we know about protein network evolution? Again, Donna alluded to that, and I only have 1 minute to talk about it, but basically what happens in protein network evolution is that these networks evolve by duplicating proteins, and you can think on duplicating a protein as though you are duplicating its interactions, and then these proteins may evolve into different functional roles, and this happens, some interactions that are either eliminated or emerge. Okay, so some interactions are added and some interactions are deleted. This usually happens by mutations in the surface of the corresponding proteins. And this is, in fact, these indel operations are the events that we see most when we try to analyze the evolution of these networks. So maybe you can try to score those events. So maybe you can try to look at two subnetworks and try to score what are the events that you observe there, the duplications, the insertions, and the deletions, and maybe by that you can get even better conserved subnetworks. So there was a work which is called, so it's here, there was a work by the lab of Mehmet Koyeturk, which is called MAWISH, in which what they do, they take two protein subsets, and the way you try to identify the subset is by some greedy local search. You take two subsets, and then you try to identify all the events, all the evolutionary events that you observe. So these events could be a matching of an interaction, a mismatch of an interaction, which means that the interaction is present in one species but not present in the other, and duplication events. You give each one of them some heuristic scoring, and then you sum these scores up and you get the score of your conserved subnetwork. Okay, so the advantage of this scoring is that maybe it's not statistical, but at least it has some evolutionary notion behind it. Okay, some evolutionary reasoning about it. Now, you can also try now to combine these scores together, and I'd like to show you that. So we presented the scoring of network blast. So its advantage was that it was probabilistic. However, it would give the same scores to these pair of conserved subnetworks and also to the pair A and C, because it doesn't care whether these two interactions are actually conserved as is. It only cares about the density of this and the density of this or this. Okay? So this had the disadvantage that it ignored sort of evolutionary principles. If we look at the Mawish scoring, it does care now whether the interactions match or mismatch. However, it doesn't care about what proteins cause this match or mismatch. For example, if these two interactions match, but this protein is a hub, you are less surprised than if these two interactions match and this protein is very low degree. So it could mean that if C is very low degree, you would like to give it a better score than to this conserved subnetwork, but you won't. You simply count how many matches and mismatches you have. So in this example, for example, you have for a match a plus one, and for a mismatch, so this is a mismatch, a minus one, so the score of both this pair and A and C is both one. Okay, so how can you sort of combine them? So the idea is to reason about a hypothetical ancestral complex and see how from this ancestral complex the two existing subnetworks were derived. So how do you reason about it? You assume that there was some closest ancestral complex that gave rise to the two subnetworks you are trying to identify. And what do you assume about this complex? You simply assume that it's densely interacting. So every edge here occurs with some high probability beta. Okay? However, in the evolution of this complex to these subnetworks, you recognize that there were some deletion and insertion events, and you want to account for them, so you can give some probability to the gain of an interaction, and you can give another probability to the loss of an interaction, and then you can basically integrate over all possible ancestral complexes that could give rise to these two conserved subnetworks and derive still a likelihood ratio scoring that has in it both the sort of the statistics and also the evolution. So now this was for two species. Can we do something similar for more than two species? So for example, in 2005, we had yeast, worm, fly as three relatively big networks. It was interesting to align them together. And it turns out that you can generalize the same framework also for more than two species. How do you do that? Well, the alignment graph, the way I presented it, is a very general structure. So you can simply, instead of a vertex corresponding to two proteins that are sequence similar, you can have a vertex corresponding to three proteins or four proteins or whatever one from each species. What is more difficult maybe, so of course the likelihood ratio score, everything is extensible. What is maybe more problematic is how do you now score, for example, three proteins? How do you score the multiple alignment of them? How do you take it into account and so on? And it's also not clear how do you balance between the sequence similarity terms and the edge similarity terms. Okay, so at least the way we solved it back then was just using a practical solution. We chose some sensible threshold for sequence similarity. We recognized that if the proteins are sequence similar enough, then their multiple alignment score are going to be very similar anyway, so we just ignored it. We just ignored it. And from now on, all the scores that I'm presenting are scores on edges only, and we forget about sequence similarity. Okay? So if you now analyze the three networks, this is the kind of picture you can get. It's sort of, and the reason I'm showing it is just to show you that by analyzing these networks, you can get some system level view of the species you are analyzing. So what you see here are the different modules, each one represented by a rectangle. With connections between them, corresponding to overlaps between them. Some of the modules here are pathways, some of them are complexes. And you can see that most of them are colored, which means that they were statistically significantly or significantly functionally enriched, which testifies to the, you know, to the fact that we are identifying real biological entities. Okay? So this is a good time to make another point about analyzing protein networks across species. And this point is that, or what I'll try to convince you is that it's stronger than constraining yourself to a single species. And to show you that, I'd like to describe another insight you can gain from these multiple species analyses. And this is about interaction prediction. So imagine that each one of those regions contains conserved subnetworks in which certain edges may be missing, and maybe you can predict them and see how you perform. So the way you can do that is by using two strategies. One is simply using what we call interlocks that Donna presented. So if you see two pairs of proteins where one pair is interacting in one species, you could predict that the other pair is interacting in the other species. So this what is called your strategy one. And strategy two would say that use the same principle, but only if all these proteins occur within a conserved subnetwork, which means that these proteins are in the same functional context. Then you believe it more. So this is strategy one plus two. And so you can see that, so this is the performance in cross-validation, so sensitivity and specificity for the prediction of interactions in the three species that were analyzed using only strategy one and strategies one and two. And you can see that using only strategy one, you get decent maybe predictions, but your specificity is much lower than what happens when you force your predictions to fall within conserved subnetworks. So when you force them to fall within conserved subnetworks, you get much more specific predictions. So we tested some of these. Yes?
The previous slide, so go back. Like the last one, you're only getting a sensitivity of 0.4%. I mean, you can achieve a specificity of 100% by just saying nothing's there.
So I must say that this is actually a success story. And the reason why it's a success story, so even this 0.4%, I don't remember how many interactions were there, but let's say hundreds. I don't really recall the number. What I do remember is that there was a follow-up study in which they actually, so some guy that deals with flies, he actually took those predictions and tested them experimentally. And I think he got a ratio of something like 50% of them were correct. And this is unheard of, because even if you take an interaction, so Donna didn't want to get into the numbers, but even if you take an interaction and test it another time or by another method, this is basically what you get, a 50% reproducibility. So even though the number, so you're right, the caveat of the multiple species analysis is that you reduce your sensitivity. But again, sometimes what you care about is not necessarily the sensitivity, but actually the specificity of your predictions. And in this sense, it's very powerful.
But you predict 100% specificity, and then in reality it was only 50%? Is that what you're saying?
So of course, this is in cross-validation, and of course the computational estimation is always an overestimation. And of course, it's always different in practice. But as I said, even if you take a true interaction and now test it in some assay of choice, you're not going to reproduce it 100% of the times. So as far as you are, you know, within the experimental reproducibility regime, then you're probably doing a very good job. So we took some of these predictions and actually tested them. We got a success rate, depending how you count, of about 40 to 50%. And this outperforms this simple interlog approach in which you predict. So this was the strategy one, in which you predict an interaction if it was observed in another species. So this shows, you know, another advantage of the multiple species analysis.
Yeah,
However, the problem with this multiple species analysis is that the larger the number of species, the bigger your alignment graph gets. So how big does it get? It becomes something like n to the k. Okay? So n to the k may be reasonable when k is 2 or when k is 3, but as I showed you, nowadays we have maybe 60 networks. So obviously we cannot hope to do the same thing for 60 networks, and this is a problem. And there were interesting approaches to attack this problem. One of them, by the group of Serafin Batsoglu, was to suggest, again, to borrow from sequences and do, so you know that in sequences when we do multiple alignments, sometimes we do progressive alignment. We start with two sequences, we then align the third one, and so on. The idea was to do the same here, which is a very nice idea. However, it didn't perform as well as doing the actual comparison. But it turns out that you can actually avoid this exponential increase in the size of the graph by recognizing that you don't have to keep an explicit representation of this graph. You can have an implicit representation, and still you can apply the same algorithmics on it. So what do I mean? So suppose that instead of now storing this network alignment graph, the test size n to the k, I simply store the original networks, and again, the dashed edges here correspond to sequence similarity edges. So I store the original network, so this is a linear representation. I don't pay anything in terms of representation. So how can I now identify a vertices of the network alignment graph? The key idea here is that these vertices hide here in the form of, if you will, vertical path. So for example, A1, A2, A3 could be such a vertex of a network alignment graph, or in general, if you don't like the word path, you can think that if we are talking about a real vertex or a real protein that plays a role in multiple species, then you would expect that if you look at the sequence similarity edges between its different incarnations in the different species, you would expect to see at least a connected subgraph. So if it's a connected subgraph, it must be a tree. So you can think about this, instead of vertical paths, you can think of about them as vertical trees that are hiding there, each one of them corresponding to a network alignment vertex. And if this is the case, we can actually use dynamic programming, if we start with some seed, to go over all these possible trees, okay, in time that is something like m times 2 to the k, or m times 3 to the k, depending on what exactly you are looking for, we can actually imitate the same algorithmics that I presented you to any number of networks. And again, the complexity of it is something like m times 2 to the k if you look for paths, m times 3 to the k if you look for trees. And so this is an example in which we apply this algorithmic idea to comparisons of more than three species and more, and you can see that even for 10 species, we get very reasonable running times. Okay. Questions on this part?
Okay.
So I'd like now to switch gears and move to a different variant of these network alignment techniques, which is network querying. And the problem is as follows. We are given some query subnetwork, some complex that we know from one species, and we would like to transfer this knowledge to another species. And the way we do it, we take the network of this other species, maybe the less well-known species, and we look for instances of the query in this target network. So what is an instance of the query? It should be somehow aligned with Q, and I'll talk about what aligned means. And of course, if we have some scoring for this alignment, we would like to find the instance with the maximal score. Okay? So what does it mean that it's aligned? So of course, the simplest notion of alignment is isomorphic alignment, which means that I'm finding, it's like subgraph isomorphism, I'm finding an exact instance of my subnetwork of interest, of my query subnetwork A in species A, in the network that I'm in, the target network of species B. Okay? So here there are only matches. However, we would like to be more flexible than that, but still maintain the, at least the topological shape of the query, and therefore we allow homeomorphic alignment. So what is a homeomorphic alignment? It means that the two subgraphs are isomorphic up to addition or deletion of vertices of degree 2. Okay, so here is the isomorphism, but you allow deletions of edges in, of vertices in the query, or insertion of vertices in the target network. So this is a line. Now, how do you score it? Well, you should somehow account for the sequence similarity scores between the nodes, for the reliability scores between the edges, and you should somehow penalize vertex deletions and vertex insertions. Okay, so this is sort of very similar to how you handle sequence alignment. And we won't have time to talk about that, but we do have approaches that allow us to somehow balance between these different contributions to the score in a rigorous way. So the score is going to look for now something as follows. You have the sum over all sequence similarities plus some penalty times the number of deletions, plus some penalty times the number of insertions, plus the weights on the interaction, the reliabilities of the interactions. So what is the complexity of that? We already mentioned that, you know, even if you look at isomorphic alignments, it's subgraph isomorphism, it's a hard problem in contrast to sequence alignment. So supposedly, there is no hope because the naive algorithms would take something like n to the k time, where k is the size of the query. So what can you do? You can reduce the complexity in three scenarios. First of all, you can reduce the complexity if you look at constrained networks. For example, there is a work by the lab of Ron Pinter, in which they consider only networks that are forests or trees, and then you have polynomial algorithms to do the querying. Another way you can reduce the complexity is by allowing the instance that you find matching the target network to contain repetitions of vertices, and I will show you that. But we will be most interested in deriving fixed parameter algorithms that run in time that is sort of a polynomial in the size of the network, but exponential in the size of the query, which is typically rather small, so say between 10 and 20 proteins. So the first algorithm that was applied in the querying scenario is in fact PathBLAST, the algorithm I just mentioned, and the idea there was to take one network as the query, the other network as the original network, and simply do network alignment. So this works to some extent, however it has no general handling of insertions and deletions, and of course it allows repetition. So proteins could occur more than once in the target network, which is not always reasonable because it would mean that the protein has to have two different functional roles within the same pathway it occurs in. Okay? So how can we handle that? How can we sort of rigorously query a network? So the idea is to use some sort of dynamic programming that is, I guess, it looks exactly like sequence alignment, okay? So you take, your best alignment up to a neighbor of your network vertex, and plus it depends now whether there was a match event, a deletion event, or an insertion event, and you simply run this dynamic programming. So it looks very simple. What is the problem with that? The problem with that is that if you apply it as is, then you get in your answers, in your matches, repetitions of vertices, which again makes the problem much easier, but is usually not very biologically feasible or correct. Okay, so one idea how to overcome that is actually to use the same dynamic algorithm, but add to the recursion that I shown you earlier, another component, which would be a subset of colors. And the subset of colors, so a la color coding, will ensure you that the match that you are identifying consists only of distinct proteins. So if you do that, you start with your network, you randomly color it, use color coding, you apply the DP algorithm, but with this added component, and then you identify the highest scoring matches. Okay. Now it turns out that this idea can be actually extended to more than just looking for query path, because this is what we focused up until now. You can actually have your query within the color coding framework being general graphs. For example, trees would work the same as it works for paths. You would sort of do bottom up with your dynamic programming. You would identify matches for subtrees and grow all the way until you find a match to the entire query. So supposedly, you can apply it to anything on which dynamic programming can be formulated. And even for general graphs, as long as they have a nice tree decomposition, you can apply the same ideas and solve the resulting problem. However, the complexity of your algorithm depends on the width of this tree decomposition. Without getting into the definition, the more tree-like your query looks like, the faster the algorithm is going to run. And the less you will pay time that is n to the power of your tree width. However, you can ask yourself whether this topology that you started with really matters, because sometimes you don't really have knowledge about the specific topology of your query. For example, you start with some complexity that you discovered using CoIP. You don't really know what is the topology, what are in the interactions that are in there. Even though maybe you can use Histohybrid to illuminate what are the interactions, but you don't actually know. We know that there is a lot of noise in the protein interaction networks and so on. So you can ask yourself, maybe I don't really need this topology. Maybe it's enough if I ignore the topology and simply look for this set of proteins occurring in some pattern in this network. What is in some pattern? The least assumption is to assume that in the target network, they are connected. Okay? So what happens if I take my query, ignore its topology if it's known. If it's not known, then there is no problem. And simply look for a connected match in this target network. So it turns out that this problem of identifying connected subgraphs that match a query, that match a query vertex set, can be again reformulated as a color coding problem. So, and the main idea, the main algorithmic idea, is that if you have a match that is connected, then in particular this match has a spanning tree. And if it has a spanning tree, it has a tree, there is a tree there, and if you can just color it with different color, you can look for a color for tree using a color coding, and therefore you can find this match. Okay, so this is the sort of the main algorithmic idea. You start with your target network, you color it randomly, you look for the best tree inside. And if you are lucky and this tree is colorful, you found a match. If not, you randomly color it again and so on. So this approach was led by a joint student of myself and Ron Shamir. Her name is Sharon Bruckner. And she implemented two approaches to this problem, a dynamic programming approach and an integer linear programming approach. And our empirical experience was that this worked faster and was more flexible, but nevertheless there were these two, so there was a fixed parameter algorithm as well as an integer linear programming approach. And when you compare the topology based matches represented here by QNET, which is sort of this tree-based expansion of QPath, if you compare the topology-free matches to these topology-based matches, then you see that the topology-free matches or the topology-free algorithm is much more sensitive, discovers more complexes, which is expected because sort of it requires less from its matches, but it's not at the price of reduced specificity because the specificity is more or less the same. Okay? And much more, using such a topology-free ID, you can query things that you couldn't query previously. For example, you can take, we've just heard that the most information that is available in any model species is foret. So you can actually take protein complexes foret and suddenly query them. You cannot do it now because we don't really have a network for it. We have a very partial network, or maybe you can try to infer it, but there is no network for it. But still, this topology-free ID bypasses this problem because now you can query every set that you want in your network. And as long as you are satisfied with matches that are simply connected and not necessarily the same topology as your query, you are fine. So I'd like to end with sort of a summary and a look ahead on this field of network alignment. And the way it's drawn here is by analogy to all the developments in sequence alignment. So of course, there is a new data that emerges. In one case, it's sequences. In another case, it's networks. And then you want to devise models of evolution for it, you want to align it, you want to do multiple alignment, and so on. And so the analogy is here. And of course, this analogy led a lot of thinking or a lot of research direction in the network alignment world. And I find it kind of interesting. So this is from some review I wrote with Trey Heidecker about 10 years ago. And I find it kind of interesting to see that what we left as question mark, because back then there was no effort made in this direction, I think our question marks still today and are still worth, you know, an effort. So one of them is, there's, as we heard, there's a lot of use of hidden Markov models in finding families of sequences. To the best of my knowledge, there is no parallel yet in biological network comparison. And of course, while we try to produce PathBLAST or NetworkBLAST, etc., while BLAST is highly used in the sequence world, we are not yet at the stage that people are routinely looking for query subnetworks in a network of interest in the biological network subfield. And that's it.
We heard and we know that the interaction is sometimes a bit ill-defined from experimental data. So sometimes the networks, you know, you have to put a threshold and you can get more or less edges in your network. So I assume that on the methods you presented, some, you know, can work with too many edges, like false positive is not a problem, while missing edges may be a problem, or the other way around. So what's your opinion? The goal is not to take each method, but if you want to apply one of the methods, like sub-network query, do you prefer to have a noisy network with too many false positives, or do you prefer to have a network with not enough edges?
It's a good question. Usually, if you are interested in biological discovery, then you mostly care about the false positives and not about the false negatives, because maybe you will discover less, but at least what you are discovering is, you know, more specific. So indeed, in most of the research that is conducted nowadays, people are using some confidence score on the edges in order to protect them from false positives. Of course, it's much harder to deal with false negatives unless you start adding sort of what we saw here in the network alignment work, some things like gap edges or things like that. So you could do that, but most of the work that I know doesn't do that, so you prefer specific predictions on top of, you know, being too permissive.
Okay. with this analogy there is, but as we saw in Uwe's talk, the pair-hidden Markov model is in a way just a probabilistic formulation of the pairwise sequence alignment. So in a way, algorithmically, if you have Smith-Waterman, you can do the pair-hidden Markov model, right? And I'm wondering whether that's true on the network level, because you do have the analog of Smith-Waterman, what you call path blast. Does that mean that essentially you have a hidden Markov model formulation, or you could have it?
So I think that the main difference is that the sequences are linear. So everything you do there, you know, is very efficient, while the networks, the paths are not evident there. You have to find them. The networks are inherently nonlinear, and therefore the analogy sort of breaks. It is true that if you now focus, if I give you now the two paths, and I ask you whether it's a good alignment or not, it's true that there you can model whatever you want, but no one is giving you. So in contrast to sequences where you can, you know.
Yeah, I understand, but that means that this path blast doesn't exactly play the same role as Smith-Waterman somehow, in a sense.
Right, it's not finding the optimal pathway alignment, of course, because we are, you know, limited by the fact that the problem is NP-hard. No, it's just, you know, it's just to give the analogy and, you know, it's...
So, is there any direction towards hashing for path alignment?
I mean, people have been using ideas from hashing to... I think... Yeah, I don't have any work at the top of my head, but this idea of hashing, you know, is being used in computational biology a lot. And I think there was also some work on hashing, you know, in networks, but I don't have it, you know, I don't know.
So, perhaps I'm not sure. As far as I know, hashing has been used in a particular way to compare networks, which is called kernels. So there are graph kernels where it's a method of visual distances, where you start by kind of hashing the local neighborhood of the nodes, and then it's easier then to find local neighborhoods that match to each other because they're the same.
Yeah, especially if we don't enforce the topology, that might be doable. Like the querying without topology.
Yeah. I'm happy to talk about that. So I don't know any work that actually does that, but... But this idea of hashing exists, right? So, and it's used a lot in sequences.
Mm-hmm. So what is the reason that biologists don't use network alignment routinely yet? Why is it?
Maybe because you don't discover complexes as often as you discover, new sequences that interest you. Maybe that's the reason. Of course, there is much less data, right? So, you know, GenBank has whatever, many sequences. Here we have, you know, 2, 3, 4 very comprehensive networks, and that's it. And the other are, you know, partial networks.
So if there's no more questions, we can thank you.